I'm sure we can all agree it's a pain to do maths in the middle of a job, but since Myford lathes are imperial, this is a situation I find myself in more often than I would like. Some parts of the lathe are easily modified to metric, like the cross slide and top slide feed screws, but a conversion to a metric lead screw would be less trivial. If we need to move the carriage, the Leadscrew Handwheel on the right is a great way to do this. If we were moving by a metric quantity, we would need to first divide by 25.4, and then add that number to whatever the dial is at, unless it exceeds 0.125 inches, i.e. the pitch of the Leadscrew, where we would need to start again from zero. Frankly, this is not acceptable. Yes, Myford make metric handwheels, and this solves half the problem, but they aren't resettable. And yes, you could use a digital readout, but they're expensive and difficult, if not impossible, to fit with a taper turning attachment, which is an accessory we often use. The optimal solution is a resettable metric lead screw dial. We start with trepanning a slice of 316 stainless steel to form a ring, which is then bored. The ring will form the dial. A groove is cut inside the ring, and I'll explain why later. An aluminium mandrel is machined, which allows accurate mounting of the ring with the help of superglue before facing and lightly chamfering. The ring is a snug fit and needs some gentle persuasion with a mallet. We've shown the dividing setup in the lathe on one of our previous videos where we make a custom DTI dial, but I'll quickly skim over it again. A mandrel is mounted in the back of the spindle, which provides a spigot to attach the George Thomas shop-made versatile dividing head. This particular Myford is a big bore, so it might look a little bit different to those of you who are familiar with the traditional Myford Super 7 or ML7 lathes. The dial graduations are marked with a V-tool mounted on its side in the tool post. After each mark is made, the spindle is indexed to the next position, which was pre-calculated and printed off as a table. To minimise the risk of a mess up, it's a good idea to start with the long graduations, then move to the medium ones, and finish with the short ones, rather than engraving each graduation sequentially. The long and medium divisions need to be marked with a corresponding number. These can be stamped, but a pantograph engraver will provide much better results. The pantograph machine is a genius device. A stencil is traced with a stylus, which is connected to a cutter mounted in a spindle through a linkage mechanism. The linkages can be adjusted to change the scale of the engraving without changing the stencil. We don't need any clever indexing system here because we can use the divisions we made earlier as a witness mark to align to the centre of the vise. To remove the ring, we use the trepanning process we demonstrated at the start of the video. Heat doesn't work here due to the larger thermal expansion coefficient of the aluminium relative to the stainless steel. Okay, so now we have the ring with its engraving, how does the entire assembly work? The friction on the resettable dial is provided with three ball bearings pushed into the groove on the inside of the ring. These ball bearings are pushed into the groove with springs, which are each contained in their respective radial holes drilled in the handwheel. We wind our own springs here since we didn't have anything the right size on hand. Before we start machining the handwheel, we need to mount it accurately in the lathe. Any significant eccentricity or lack of axiality will cause the dial to visibly wobble as the handwheel is turned. Our eyes are surprisingly sensitive to small inaccuracies, so an arbor is machined in situ to mount the handwheel. The end of the arbor is drilled and tapped so the handwheel can be clamped in place. The handwheel is a push fit on the arbor, which helps reduce inaccuracies in holding. Now it's time to machine the handwheel. This can be a bit of a scary concept, but remember that new handwheels can be purchased in the event of an accident, and the dial itself can be made before machining the handwheel. Also note that older spoked handwheels don't have enough thickness to make this conversion, although it might be possible to machine a thinner ring and use an O-ring to provide the dial friction. The handwheel is transferred to the milling machine for drilling the radial holes. An easy way to find the center position is to use a rounded stub in the chuck, and the y-axis can then be moved until a strip of metal placed between the handwheel and stub is horizontal. This is especially accurate on small diameter components and when taking an average by rotating the spindle. The radial holes are then drilled and a recess is made with an end mill. Now it's time to test it out. The old handwheel is removed and then replaced with the new one. The level of friction here is just right. It needs to be stiff enough to not move if the handwheel is operated with the dial, and yet easy enough so it is easy to set. As you can see here, we also made the numbers on the longest graduations larger. This makes the dial super easy to read. If any of you are interested in reproducing this project, just let us know in the comments and we'll be happy to prepare some drawings. And yes, they will be metric. Thanks for watching, and if you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe.